Welcome everybody, we've got another great panel today. Let me introduce the panelists. First myself, I'm the moderator, Don Keller. I'm a partner at Orrick in the Emerging Companies Group here in Menlo Park. We've got three panelists that have a venture background. David Hornik from August Capital, Jake Flomenberg from Accel,
and
and DJ Patil from Greylock. And would you call yourself a venture capitalist or?
I would not put myself in the category of David Hornik. That's not answering the question.
And we've got three entrepreneurs with big data related companies. Roman Stanek with GoodData, the CEO and founder of GoodData. Ben Werther, CEO of Platfora. And Stephen Sorkin, VP Server Engineering at Splunk. So we've got a great panel. And the format is to be as interactive as the audience wants to be. So any questions you have throughout the panel, just let us know and be glad to bring the questions up. So the first comment I've got is we've been doing a lot of these panels on clean tech over the last couple of years. And we do often do one a quarter. And a couple of months ago, I had a clean tech client that wanted to be introduced to a couple of venture guys. And I sent it over to a clean tech venture person. He sent it right back saying, No, I'm not doing clean tech anymore. I'm only doing big data. So the first question is it time to short big data? And Stephen, I saw your video online on big data. It was very good. So why don't we start with what is big data? Let's take the mystery out of that.
Then we'll short it.
Well, I'd like to use a couple of different definitions for big data. And probably my favorite one comes from the guys at the AMP lab at UC Berkeley. So it's the Algorithms, Machines, and People lab. And they call big data the set of problems that current technology can't solve either because it's too expensive, too slow, or not high enough quality. And it's kind of a cop-out answer because as time goes on, the incumbent solutions will handle more and more, and there's always going to be more problems that you can't solve with the current technology. The other, perhaps more conventional definition is big data is the set of data problems that involve one or more of the four Vs. There's volume, so how much data is under management, velocity, how much data is being added to that data under management, say on a daily basis. Variety, so how many different types of data do you have to deal with, and variability, which is how often do the types of data you have to deal with change. So in general, big data is a question of problems that are difficult to solve because of the unpredictability of the data or the size of the data.
Okay, and I took a look at the websites of the three companies we have represented on here. They all look like great companies, and we're all very familiar with them. What are each of your competitive advantages? The companies looked somewhat similar to me. Roman, why don't you start with that?
So first of all, you know, I'm almost ready to short big data. And here's why. I actually believe that most of the big data discussion, even this definition, focuses on technology, what's actually possible, and it doesn't focus enough on adoption, who can use it, who gets any value out of it, and so on. And that's kind of the key differentiation of data at my company. We actually don't sell big data as technology, we sell it as a business solution to the business people, so we actually package it so that it can be used and people can actually monetize big data. And most of the discussion, especially in the Valley, around big data I see is all about you know, the petabytes and terabytes and gigabytes and gigabytes and so on. And I don't see enough discussion about who's going to use it and what's the UI, how you get data in, and so on.
Do people actually know where the term big data comes from, Ethan?
No.
By people, do you mean me? Because the answer is no. It happened when David Hornik and I were drinking one time. It actually comes from Roger Margulis, who's at O'Reilly, been there for a long time. And so one of the big challenges about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, was when people were even starting to talk about data or even trying to get anything done with data, no one would pay attention. It was just a classic kind of argument of Teradata, Informatica, all these systems. And nobody was even paying attention to companies like Greenplum, Astrodata, Vertica, any of these solutions. And so Roger, in his attempt to try to just get people to even pay attention to the issue, started saying big data. The challenge with that is it's been hijacked as this kind of thing of like, ooh, wow, we have to put everything into the notion of big data, rather than saying, hey, let's actually solve a problem.
Yeah. I think, from outside of Platfora, you know, first of all, you know, big data is a term, as DJ says, and every company is now suddenly a big data company. I think there is a real shift that's going on, though. There is something very real. So I used to run product at Greenplum, and we talked about big data, but at the end of the day, it was just about building a bigger data warehouse. And, you know, you could store petabytes of data in any of those big systems, Teradata, Oracle, kind of you name it. I think the change that we see, that we hear again and again, is before you used to know half the questions you wanted to answer ahead of time. And that meant you could organize a data warehouse, and you could do all these things you've done for 25 years. Really, for me at least, big data means I don't know how I'm going to want to use this data yet. I don't, the value, it's almost like, people say, well, I want information, not data. Well, you only know you want information when you know what question you want to answer. So all that data is a resource. If you don't know how you're going to organize it, because you don't know the questions yet, you need to store a whole lot more raw stuff, and you need to be in a much better position to try to turn that around kind of reactively as you need answers. And so all the methodologies of the past that were about knowing everything I wanted ahead of time start to break down, and you start just swimming in raw stuff that you don't know what to do with, and then you have to store the raw stuff and figure out how do I then do useful things with it, so I'm not just starting from scratch and spending a year hiring up a whole new IT team every time you need to go answer the next question. And I think that's a lot of the heart of the problem that we see people kind of wrestling with today.
So I think the interesting, you know, are we shorting big data? I think the answer is no. I think everything is big data, as sort of has been described. I described in a post on VentureBlog recently, actually not recently, because I write it like once a decade, but in a post about this, I sort of described this shift that we saw in social, where in the early days of social, social was a thing. Okay, we're now going to build social, and you would, oh, I'm going to invest in the social company, and then over a relatively short period of time, it became perfectly clear that everything had to be social, and if it wasn't social, it was dead. And if it was social, then it had this capacity then to be living and breathing and succeed in the current environment. And I think that's where we are with big data, which is to say, this idea that there are these platform, these big data platforms, and we should be investing now in the platform because, boy, there's a whole bunch of data. Well, you know, yeah, that's true, but the real value is that big data is now informing everything we do, that any company that's being built has to understand that there are a massive number of data points that can be captured and then value can be extracted from it. And those companies that are doing that, that are using the Splunks of this world to gather that data and better understand it, are going to succeed, and those that aren't will fail. And so I think it's big data as a platform. Its data is an enabler. It's not that data is something in and of itself. So that's how I'm at least thinking about it at this point.
Jake, why don't you give us your sense of the map of the way the venture world, or at least you guys, are looking at it?
Sure. Well, I mean, at the highest level, if you sort of draw the conceptual stack, the simplest way you can split the world is to above the data and below the data. And sort of below the data is all the infrastructure that the data rests on, whether it's the converged storage or the software-defined networking, the infrastructure, the service, the management, the security, and the actual data platform. These are all the things that the data rests on. And on top of it, there are, you know, at least two or three buckets in my mind. One is data as a product, which we're seeing more and more, people that actually want to take data and sell it to other folks. There's data products that actually help you manipulate the data and ask questions on an ad hoc basis that many of these companies fall in. And then there are data-driven products, and these are really the reinventions of a lot of the old legacy players, just a new approach that are more fundamentally data-driven, whether it's CRM, ERP, supply chain management, or any of the needs that a business has. And you know, what I'd say from an investment perspective is that that stuff below the data is extremely important, and a lot of investments have already been made and will continue to be made. I think now the ecosystem is reaching a level of maturity, finally, where you don't have to have the technical chops that these guys sitting around me do to be able to have a chance to make sense of this data. And you can leverage some of the tools that they and others are building to build these applications that sit on top of the data. And the ones that will become the most powerful are those that find that initial key use case that really resonates with the user and then has an opportunity to grow broader. And I think we're just sort of at the beginning of the cycle where, you know, I hope to see a lot more of the apps that sit on top of these data platforms.
Roman, you mentioned that at the beginning. Are you building the apps that sit on top so that it's easily implementable, or how do you address that?
Absolutely, and I actually believe that. I absolutely agree with this, and I like the word big data platform. I don't believe that big data will be sold and adopted the same way Oracle was adopted, that every company will have a small, you know, Hadoop, you know, cluster and so on. I think we will actually see more and more data platforms where companies will actually be able to use big data by using services of one or many data platforms. Like, I use big data every day, and everybody does. When we tweet and we get suggestions who should be followed, that's big data, but I didn't install anything. It's part of, you know, an app. So I think that data-informed applications, data platforms, that's a real future for big data, less than the basic infrastructure below the data line. And so what we do is essentially we host that stuff below the data line. We know it's difficult to sell to companies, and we build a big data application on top of it that we sell to the business people. But again, it's packaged as an app that a business person can understand.
It's offered as a package software or a service?
It's a service. I don't think that anybody talks about, you know,
software.
Exactly.
Yeah. And for any given company that you go see, does it have to be customized quite a bit, or is it?
There are different use cases, you know. So the beauty, what also happened over the last 5 years, not only the big data thing, but also the API economy. It used to be that every piece of data was in a, you know, completely random form, and it was completely unscalable to build a company like GoodData. We have now 6,000 customers, and most of them use GoodData with the same API. So there's a much greater deal of repeatability and scalability and so on. So every Salesforce user, every Zendesk user, they all have the same APIs, and they all have the same data sources, you know, Twitter and Facebook and so on. So I actually see multiple megatrends happening at the same time, and big data is one of it.
So it's basically any company out there that's you know, got enough revenue to support this, need this solution?
Yeah, I think that, example, you know, as we said, everything is now being measured, everything measurable, so we have now, you know, most of the processes, social and so on, are generating so much data that's beyond, you know, any company to actually, you know, capabilities to analyze it.
I think it's also critical that as these systems allow you to use more data, let's take some very classic, easy one to think about, because I think like that notion of, well, does everyone have a Hadoop system installed? Probably not, but you're going to use a system that uses that sometimes.
Exactly.
So Google Analytics, or, you know, take your favorite thing, Splunk, or whatever system, they may be processing lots of data for you. Who's interpreting that data? Who's your version of Spock on the bridge? Who's that person that says, hey, you know, here's what's interesting and what happens? And that's part of the big shift that we're starting to see around data is, great, so we've enabled people to use data. We've created you, we've given you the ability to be incredibly stupid faster. So how do we actually put people in place that now give you and transform that information into a narrative, into a story that help you actually understand this?
You know, I think there's a social phenomenon that's going on, which is, you know, before DJ was just a geek, and now he's a hero because he's a data scientist. And up until now, the data scientist was just actually an actuary. And they were, you know, and I was like, really? What do you do? Oh, I come into my office every day, I look at a ton of numbers, and I figure out when you'll die. And, you know, wow, it turns out actually it was considered the best job on the planet, even before you were now awesome superhero. But now you've changed, oh, I'm an actuary, now I'm a data scientist. And everybody needs one, and they think you're cool and you can can wear, you know, cool clothing. And stuff.
Yes. I resemble that remark. Yes.
Yeah. I think, you know, this whole idea of the data scientist, it's amazing. I mean, there's some amazing data science work being done, but there's this analogy I kind of heard talked about a few times of sort of pre-industrial age, where there was an age before we had like mass machinery building, you know, plates and forks and knives, and you'd go to a silversmith to go make the stuff on your table, and it was like, well, at that rate, if we want to scale and give everyone in the world this stuff, we're going to need a million silversmiths, you know, a million blacksmiths. And so it's like that, the number one mission has to be, let's like train everybody up as a blacksmith or else this is going to work. And then at some point, someone invented a machine that started making this stuff, and it's like, oh, okay, we're okay, we don't need quite as many. So I think there is definitely an essential need, but I think 90% of what, or 80% or some percentage of what is today data science is really just lack of tooling. And better tooling is going to get a whole lot easier. And then the real data science work can really be focused on the right stuff. It's not that it's really important stuff, but it's so much of it is people just have no fluency with the data or easy ability to self-serve and discover and have democratized access. And so they're hiring high-paid consultants to do the easy stuff and not just the hard stuff.
I mean, actually, you've just described everything I fund, basically, right? Everything, it's like, you know, and then there were a horde of people who did this thing and now toucan. Okay, I'll fund you. Like, I mean, you, whatever it is, it's in payroll or it's in running systems or it's, so, but it's a great analogy. I think that's exactly right. Like our job is to figure out how to do exactly that for everything.
Yeah. Well, I think you're talking about two very important distinct points. One is how do you basically enable everyone in your company to be a data scientist? And how do you make everyone smarter with the data? And there's a technology platform facilitation level, and there's another thing which is cultural. And the companies that silo data away, they do not democratize the data so everyone can ask a question. They go into meetings and they have a meeting with the intention of making a decision around data rather than having a conversation around the data. And then making everyone smarter. And that's a big shift that we're seeing in the new form of companies and how companies are, it's the same equivalent of being agile or that analogy of that, we're seeing that as a cultural shift in the way people interpret data.
I disagree.
About time.
That was the plan. No, I don't think people want to be data scientists. I don't think that most people, you know, the customers I talk to, the first reaction is I don't even know what to measure. You know, so that's, you know, I think I have a fundamental problem with believing that, you know, everybody wants to be data scientist. That I know that, you know, it's a cool job and you have school and so on, but people don't want to be data scientists. They want to know what's going on, they want to know what will get happen and so on, but they don't want to be data scientists.
I agree with Roman on this, because if you need to understand data, you need to understand two separate things. You need to understand the structure of the data. So what do each of these metrics actually mean? And then you have to understand the statistics behind making use of the data. And most people don't have either of those skills. So what you need is you need those machines that stamp out the forks and the knives and the spoons, which is the applications built on top of the platforms that help you make sense of a particular slice of data or a constellation of data in a meaningful way.
And so I think I was saying, do people fundamentally want to ask questions of their data? Are there people in middle America that are trying to perform a job and, you know, they just want to complete it? They don't want to sit and experiment with their data and figure out what to ask of it. And what I've seen over and over again is that people don't know where to start. But if you give them somewhere to start, whether it's the pre-built apps from a company like GoodData or Splunk, they can look at these sort of best practices for whatever job they're trying to do. And then from looking at that, they can imitate and elaborate. They can say, you know, this is a great view, this is a great analysis, but what if I want to do this, or what if I want to slice it that way? And there the ability for these big data platforms and architectures to support the user to ask that ad hoc question really takes it from a world in which people aren't asking questions to which people are a lot more like data scientists and although with less sophistication to ask those types of questions.
Do you guys provide training?
Is that part of your product offering or you don't need training?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. That embodies the problem. That exactly
absolutely not.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, one where we're in beta, so we're training, we're working with our early customers. I think this one, just to sort of answer that last question for a second, if you look at pre-big data terms, right, there was 95% of what you're doing is sort of dashboarding, of like in this data context. I want to look at something that came up on my phone, my tablet, my web page, and I doesn't look right, if not, I call somebody, or I click a button, you know. 5% might be exploratory BI using like, you know, desktop products like Tableau or things like that, and then maybe 1%, and I know it doesn't add to 100, but 1% of those people are doing using SaaS and starting to do more statistical things and are the more advanced users. And I think that's the same thing in this context. I mean, a lot of stuff in this new world is effectively operational, dashboarding, reporting, things that, you know, you don't want to, you want to look at whether your measurement came back, right, if things are breaking, and if they are, you'll look into it. Some percentage of that, I've got a question about my data. Why is this so? And that doesn't start with statistics. It starts with just exploring, slicing and dicing, being able to be fluent against whether it's 100 terabytes or 100 petabytes, being able to slice and dice that data. And then you get into the advanced, okay, now I understand this, and I wanna cluster those that population, and I wanna figure out whether I can do some advanced technique to be even smarter at predicting behavior or creating closed loop things. And so I think we're not disagreeing, we're just looking at other different ends of the spectrum. And
let's just take training for a quick example. And I think this is, I think it's ridiculous that anybody has to go to training. I mean, if you go to training, when's the last time you went to a training session where you sit there and you learn some HR system or ERP system, and you sit there and you sit, it's like 4 hours later, you're like, someone please shoot me. And you know, you're like, thank God Twitter and Facebook are here. And it's horrible. Yet, you know, my kids who can't read can figure out Angry Birds and kick my ass. We use Google. When's the last time you took a training class for Google? Right, that's a data product. These things are there. And one of the challenges I think we do is we try to build these systems in a way that is not consumerized. And one of the things that we're starting to see this innovation of is the on-ramp and the process of what people can actually start using stuff. And I think one of the big challenges is because we're trying to build this tool for the pros, the pro data scientists, rather than saying, hey, anybody can be a data scientist. And if we are going to take that approach, the word we should think of is augmentation. How do we make the data more dynamic, more sort of natural, that sort of says, hey, you should think about this. Here's a new way to actually, to augment you, to become smarter. And that's what you use Google every day for. That's when you pull up Yelp to find out something about a restaurant. You're using lots of data to make a more informed decision. That same process is where we have to take these technologies that work on lots and lots of data to make it simple.
Steven, did you say you guys do provide training?
Absolutely. I mean, certainly at the simplest end of the system, it's like Google. So the Splunk 5 years ago was Google for log files, Google for machine data. And that's still a good chunk of the use cases of Splunk. And for that type of use case, no, you don't need training. Google was the original big data system that almost everyone in this room was exposed to. But of course, if you ask Google what do their set of queries look like, on average, a Google search has 1.6 terms. So the space of questions that you can ask of Google using the plain old interface is fairly simple. I mean, most people use it for the simplest use case, and that's probably 80%. But as you start to layer on more complex use cases, I want to do something like a statistical analysis. I want to slice and dice the data. I want to predict values of the data. That's certainly, you can have an app layer built on top of this underlying platform that provides and abstracts that type of understanding of the data. But someone has to learn how to build that app layer on top. And so for Splunk, our training offers the ability for developers and administrators to understand, how do I build these dashboards? How do I parameterize the dashboards so that anyone in the enterprise can use the product? So if you look at a big company that's using Splunk as a system for first or second level support, where you type in a customer's ID or a customer's phone number or a customer's address and they find out everything, that user doesn't have to go through training, but the person who builds that dashboard probably does have to go through training to understand how to build it the right way. You can learn to program on your own, but that's not typically how the best software engineers learn to program.
Roman, you completely disagree with it.
Yeah, I completely disagree. I always believe that people's ability to understand and interpret data is kind of continuum. So you go from somebody who can only look at, Excel spreadsheet, two-dimensional stuff, and it goes all the way to, very advanced data scientists who can do, kind of advanced segmentation and statistical stuff and so on. And I actually believe that the kind of the segmentation drops off at the Excel pivot table, so most people don't get to that level. Whoever gets to the Excel pivot table level can do many things, but most people can. And that's why, I'm building products for those people who want to understand and use data as part of their job. And we cannot do training. It has to come in a package and the visuals and the data story and so on that it's easily understandable by people who want to use it. It takes us 6 months to build a package that I can go to a business person and get that level of adoption.
Ben, where are you guys fit in this?
I think some of the same. Well, we think about this a consumption mode of what we build. For the 95%, there's this idea that it comes up on your web page or tablet. And for that, when VP of marketing is getting something, they're not going to sit through any training. So you assume that it's got to look like a web page and you click. But for somebody who's a business analyst, I think there's a certain amount of, it should take them maybe 2 hours to become proficient. And it's not that they go and sit for a whole day or take a month-long, certification or anything like that. But, there's probably a little bit of just, here's some things you need to know to get going. And if you don't even get that, then there's probably some tricks and things that we can give the best practices and make it a little easier. But honestly, we're in beta now with early customers. We're launching in the coming months, and you'll see we'll get a very interesting firsthand look at what happens when we go beyond those early customers we're working with today and try to scale that 100x across companies where we won't have that direct contact. Hopefully, all the usability work we're doing will come.
It's just, but it's a different business, right? I mean, ultimately, all you're doing is describing different businesses. Ultimately, when I funded Splunk, it was three guys in this idea that, if we could just do a better job of understanding log files, then we could get to fixing systems more quickly. And as you described, that was a search interface on top of machine data. And if that is all that it was, then you'd say, okay, great. The only people it will serve will be extremely technical people who can understand and interpret the results, right? The power of Google is that it comes back in English and you can read it. Splunk comes back in tech. And so, so the average person can't read it. Splunk has obviously evolved over time as a platform, and so the strength of it is that it can be used for anything. The challenge is that you then have to figure out how to put it to use. Right, so now there are apps that are being built on top of it for these vertical things that then one doesn't need the training for. Okay, I'm using it for X and I understand it. You guys are going after the market from a vertical perspective. You're building apps that serve a specific purpose, right? So for sure, right, when in the end a Splunk built, when an app is built on Splunk, you want people to be able to use it and it to be intuitive. But at the at Steven's basic nerd level, he's like, we can build anything on this thing, and that requires training. So I think that ultimately we all have the same goal, which is to illuminate data to help make business decisions. And the only question is, are you at this fundamental platform layer, or are you building apps on top of it that are then used by business people?
So David, are you funding companies that are basically vertical apps on top of Splunk?
If you have one, it's good for everyone. it reminds me a little bit of the conversation, again, going back to social, which was, can you build a giant company, can you build a venture-scale business on top of Facebook? Can you build a venture-scale business on top of LinkedIn, right? Can you build a venture-scale business on top of Twitter? These things are platforms, right? And so are they big enough platforms, broad enough platforms, that you can then build a derivative business, something that sits on top of it that still is a $1 billion business, right? It's clear to me that you can build vertical businesses that can drive $1 billion worth of value. what the underlying platform of that. If you, you know, if you want to build it on Splunk, that's amazing, and as far as that's a win-win for me, I'm all for that. But I think if you look at data, as I said, as a platform, the idea that these, that there are verticals that will derive enough power and value that people will spend, you know, ultimately hundreds of millions of dollars on it, there's no question in my mind those things exist, and that, and I will very happily fund them when they come before me.
I can give you two quick, crisp articulations of where those gaps are in data. The first is the data process is still incredibly brittle. Things just break all the time. The interface between these systems, or even in the system itself, just due to the nature of some of the data problems. So anywhere where you sit on this ecosystem of helping address brittleness, you are going to be able to have a real value solution. The other part is part of this is moving from just producing data or lots of data vomit to insights, and then finally actionability. And if you're on either of those side systems, it doesn't matter if you are the platform or sitting on somebody's platform that enables that. You're going to have something that has immediate addressable value.
Yeah, just to make a specific example, we were talking to a large retailer, brand you would all know. So they had their traditional BI data warehousing loading systems. We talked about the case where they want to get one field in a report. There wasn't, like, they didn't think to include this thing about customers. They want to now include it all the way end to end. You think, how long could that possibly take to do this, right? So think, how about this? 8 to 9 months, three outsource firms working together, monthly risk mitigation meetings, you know, 10 engineers for one column. So you wonder why they think, that's too hard. We're going to live within the world of demands with today's systems. And so virtually every question they ask is driven by what are they able to ask based on what they decided 5 years ago when they built the system. That's what most companies are living with today. It's a very, very messed up place.
So when you guys go out to sell now, your three companies, are you evangelizing still and convincing people that they need this? Or is this something that they're coming to you and say, I got to have this, my data is not sufficient?
Yeah, from outside, so we're all about making Hadoop useful. So Hadoop is this great technology. When you have this tons of data, and you start storing it, it's like this big cardboard box, you dump all the data in, and that's very easy, but then actually doing anything with the data when it's in there is very, very hard today. And nobody, whether you're Facebook, JP Morgan, or intelligence agencies, has a good answer for this today. And so the nice thing about it is we make it a whole lot easier, and we get people chasing us to beta our product, which is fun. So we're excited when we unveil this, what's gonna happen, but feedback's been very, very strong so far.
And why are they betaing your product as compared to Splunk?
I think we solve a different problem. I mean, the data, Splunk's a great product. We focus on, I think about Splunk, and I don't want to mischaracterize, but as it's trying to find sort of the needles in the haystack, the detail items, the outliers where something popped up that shouldn't be there. Where we're much more thinking about aggregating and distilling. Like, I want to look at purchases by across all my population, find population sets of interest. Let me look at how this population differed from this one. Let me then drill in and look at characteristics in aggregate and drill down into them. So it's a view of sort of behaviors in aggregate distilling down to the details versus a focus on the details, if that makes sense. And it's a little nuanced, but I think at the end of the day, it's really the characteristics of business, questions about business data versus questions about IT data. I'm probably mischaracterizing
this. It's a little bit of a mischaracterization, but in the sales motion for Splunk.
You do it all the time in the sales.
For Splunk, the way that the product is typically sold is that someone will download the product. We have a free download on our website that lets you bring in 500 megabytes of data a day for essentially ever. And so that's often how customers find out about the product. They download it, they throw some data in, they solve a useful problem very quickly, in a few minutes on their own, without any intervention from our field team, and then they say, we need the product. And then they call us up and ask how much it costs, which is terrific. And so
they're coming to you?
They're almost always coming to me, to the company. And the problems that they solve are usually ones involving machine data, whether it's IT problems or business problems, whether it's needle in the haystack, or business type problems. our customers are bringing in data from one machine talking to another machine, a web browser talking to a web server, a firewall talking to a network, another network device, and we can solve the problem of beetle in the haystack. Tell me what are the anomalous events. They can solve problems involving. Tell me the trends over time. One of the important distinctions with other types of systems is Splunk is real time at its core. So we let you interact with data quickly, shortly after the data arrives. So for us, compared to other batch analytic systems, one of the most important things is being able to interact with the data in a very timely manner.
So, you know, not to make this a all about Splunk, although the three of us have very deep here ties to Splunk, but we just reported quarterly earnings. Earnings grew, earnings last year were over $100 million, and when we reported 71% earnings growth, I mean, the reaction of the market was the appropriate reaction, which is people are buying this stuff. People need it, they're expanding how they're spending, et cetera. So, which is great news, and I think that the footprint for all of us is massive, right? That's just the very point of the wedge, and there's going to be a lot of there's going to be a lot of opportunity going on.
Two comments. The first one, what I really like was this notion that data is very brittle, and it actually is not a product; it's a value chain. You know, it takes 18 months, not because people are stupid, but because there are too many vendors and components involved in dealing with data. And that's my main selling point, is data, that I actually provide a whole value chain as a product. And the way we actually sell, we have an interesting model. Most of our revenue is actually OEM. We offer this value chain to other SaaS companies who need to get analytics to their customers. So it's essentially, they don't need to build it. All they do is they dump their data to GoodData, and we provide analytics and reporting and everything else to their customers. And so that's a very fast growing part of our business.
So who are those OEMs?
The OEMs would be Group Commerce, Blink Media, Zendesk, Get Satisfaction, 50 companies, Marketron. So medium and large SaaS companies. And essentially, instead of building that value chain and hosting it internally, that takes 18 months and it's very expensive and they would never be good at it, all they do is they sign up over data, we give them that ability to essentially, load all of their data to us and they white label the data and sell it under their name. And it's going really well. We don't announce our results, but this quarter will be, almost, the revenue this quarter will be almost as big as last year. So the full year.
Pretty fast growth.
So what are the impediments to your guys' growth as companies now? Is it technology adoption or product adoption? Is it structural in the hardware? Or is it just as fast as you can sell it? What are the things that slow you down?
I actually, and that's a very good question for many companies in the Valley. There was this article over the weekend about VMware and their latest cloud announcement, and how much, they made a cloud announcement in front of 20,000 IT people in the room, and nobody cares. So I think that the biggest problem that big data, industry has is that buyer in any company is a overworked IT person who is too busy, they have their problems, they don't really care about business people, and at most they have time to download Splunk and use it to solve their problems. So that's why Splunk grows so well. So there must be different ways how to sell, and I think that's a structural problem for big data.
Yeah, I mean, it might sound obvious, but across all the companies, the thing that I see inhibiting growth the most is just helping people identify use cases that matter. It's an interesting question as to where we're at in the big data hype cycle, and there's sort of pluses and minuses of both. But there are literally a few CIOs out there that are saying, I need a big data strategy. It's sort of, a statement that doesn't have any meaning. I want to trial one of these platforms, but I have no idea what I want to derive from it. And as a company trying to going through the process of teaching them the potential, right? That's a long process, and it may not yield any results. But to be able to walk in there and say, I now have a dozen different apps that solve all these discrete use cases. There's a Splunk-based app platform that has over 300 apps, and you know, I'm sure Platfora is working on a couple of things as well. So I think just finding those customers with those discrete use cases and helping grow that number is what's going to drive the long-term trajectory of these companies.
I think for us, and I think for a lot of the customers we work with, big data is synonymous with Hadoop, this technology that is about, it's not the only thing that you call big data, but I think if you ask at the heart of it for most people, it's this idea that I can now store all of this data and start to use it in this raw form. And I think that you get two extremes. I mean, to Jake's point, talking to the CIO of a Fortune 500 company who said, look, we can't be throwing away any more data, so this year's strategy is we're going to put everything that goes anywhere else also goes into Hadoop. And you know what? Next year we figure out what we can do with that data and how we use it. And it's a perverse thing to think that like that's a real strategy. But for him, the idea that he'd throw that data away and then he get asked a business question a year from now and not have that data is even more painful. So that's a mandate, that's the starting point. But I think step two is we are beginning to see, there's this sort of interesting backlash where Hadoop itself is a amazing technology and an incredibly raw technology in a lot of ways. And so, you literally now, like 2 years ago, people would come to conferences and they'd have used it, they know what it is, and they'd come in and they'd be ready to sort of dig into the details. Now you get people coming out and saying, hey, my boss told me I need to get us a Hadoop. And it's like, all right, and so the people who will start to install it, and then they'll be like, well, where's the UI? Where do I go? And get dissatisfied very quickly. And we've seen examples where people have taken a step down a big data strategy, rolled it out of the business has said, what do I do with this? And then have sort of shelved it for the moment. And the mandate's still there, it's still just as important, but they kind of didn't know where to go yet. And so I think what we're trying to do, honestly, is help that take that like that adoption curve to leap so we don't get this huge trough of disillusionment and we can actually make these technologies useful and focus on the next curve. Because otherwise we have to go down the trough of disillusionment, wait for Gartner apartments, and then kind of wait for the plateau of productivity to arrive and slow down.
That's gonna happen.
My question is, do IT buying cycles matter to you guys right now? Specifically GoodData and Platfora. I understand why Splunk may be immune to it, but for you guys, does it matter?
No, my approach is to be completely outside of IT buying cycles. I think that IT is in general too busy keeping the lights on. They have no ability to bring innovation into companies anymore. So, and the real innovation that's happening in companies is the consumerization. It's the business people bringing technologies inside of them. So. The data warehouse used to be the place where data goes to die. I don't want to, big data be that place. So I'm not selling to IT.
So who would you typically sell to?
Oh, any line of business owner. Any line of business, all the way from CEO to a line of business owner in small and big companies.
Yeah, I think for us, I think in some organizations it probably is. I mean, we think about both top down and bottom up, which is that, there's with this new stuff, there are CIOs who demand that the companies doing stuff immediately and they understand what they need to do. And there's also many that say, hey, we need a big data strategy. And somewhere down in the trenches, people are starting to figure out this stuff from the ground up. And if you don't want to wait for the CIO to percolate down. I mean, so we're sort of trying to sort of feed it from both ends, which means making it very easy for people to sort of start adopting it and using it, but at the same time, being able to participate. And at the end of the day, we want to sell. But it's a little bit like the Splunk strategy. You want to get in everywhere and then be able to sell big deals on top of that. And I think if you do that well, you sort of maybe the buying cycles factor in terms of timing of the deals. But at the end of the day, you're building footprint anyway continuously. And it's just about smoothing out your revenue, so it's not a big deal.
As a buyer of both Splunk and Greenplum when we're at LinkedIn, I think one of the big fundamental shifts that we're starting to see in the CIO shop is. The way I describe it is a toolbox model. And what the typical response of the CIO is that you get to pick one technology. And that's like the equivalent of like the plumbing is not working on Sunday night, and then you call up the plumber and he's like, well, which tool do you want me to bring over? It's like, you get one. It's just asinine.
So how do you manage that saying, oh, we need a toolbox, a suite of technologies that's going to work to address the brittleness and all this other pain across the different verticals inside an organization, and at the same time be able to manage both the cost structure as well as the support structure of what it takes to make that actually a usable solution?
This sounds like something that Accenture and the other consulting firms are making a ton of money on. Is that fair? Are they?
They're trying. they're working hard. I mean, Cognizant has just spun up a big thing. Accenture spun up a big thing. Everyone's calling them data scientists, which they're no longer. I heard a data scientist is a West Coast analyst.
Salary of data scientist is proportional to the distance. Proportional to the distance from Silicon Valley.
Right, yeah. And so we're starting to see this, and we're starting to do that. And part of the challenge here is what is snake oil and what is real. And I think there's a lot of froth and hype in there, and people who are overselling with just classic systems and just rebranding it.
Are the consulting firms engaged on the front end for a pre-sale, or are they engaged post-sale, or both?
Yeah, I think they're trying to be in all of it at some level. I think it's, I mean, where this is sort of going to shake out is, you know, a lot of them will be towards making this stuff complicated. The last generations of technology were very complicated. You needed a lot of help. You know, to implement a data warehouse and BI and all these things, you could do it yourself, but you pay these guys a lot of money. You know, we're all focused on how you make this stuff easy in a way that you may need the help for some things, but a lot of it is, you know, I mean, we just installed our product at a beta against a couple petabytes of data in 4 hours. You know, it's a whole different game these days. So, you know, it's, so I think there is a lot of democratization that's going to happen that is a threatening to these guys at the same time as there's also a lot of business for them. And I think that's going to be interesting to see how it shakes out.
And do you guys, as companies, offer services as well? Not just software as a service, but consulting-like services, or is that just not part of the equation?
We do, absolutely. Absolutely. Again, it's part of selling to, you know, line of business. We have to offer some services. But I would go back to this, you know, the SIs, the system integrators. They love two things. They love complexity and control. And simple solutions, data platforms, you know, are not complex and they don't give that control. So we always have to look for the new SIs who actually make money of simplicity and democratization. But there is always, you know, the enterprise software has to be about, you know, a little bit about services. We cannot be completely service heavy, but every business is slightly different. People actually want to express what they know about their business in our products, and it takes some services.
Splunk's fundamentally a software company. We do offer services, but that's typically a very small fraction of the Splunk deployment. We try to make sure that the software stands on its own. It's easy to set up. It's easy to use. There doesn't have to be much customization up front. It's the exception rather than the rule.
I have two Splunk guys in my staff. Yeah, yeah. Services.
Yeah.
One of the different approaches we try to take is actually build a community around this in a different way. And so a number of us, many of the guys here have been influential in this, is we spun up a conference called Strata Conference, joint with O'Reilly, that we try to bring this community that thinks this new way together so that we're trying to give the ability to uplift everyone at the same time. We've created this program called the Data Insights Fellowship, where we're taking people who are academics and giving them an opportunity to spend several weeks here in Silicon Valley working with companies to actually train to become data scientists so they can go into an organization, they know how to use some of these technologies, so they can act as, the way we like to think of this is how do we create individuals that can be catalysts or enzymes inside an organization to make the data more digestible and easier to adopt.
Sure. Have you guys put together ROI analysis for companies, and is that difficult to do in this context? It seems difficult.
I think we'd rather prove it on the ground. You know, I think it's one of those things where, you know,
you avoid that question.
You look at the different generations of Green Farm, you know, so you, before, you know, in my world of before data warehousing, you know, Teradata would go in, big ROI, big footprint, take, you know, a long time to get up and running. The teaser won by, they drop ship you a rack of gear and be up and running in 4 to 6 weeks. You know, Green Farm, we were software, and we'd be up and running in 2 weeks competing with those guys. even faster. I think we're entering the world now where it's about prove it to me before the CIO even knows the thing's there. And if you have to, people should be evangelizing the benefits of it before anyone even cares.
Yeah, I agree that you're not selling on a, oh, here's the ROI, we'll deliver 10x the value of the price you paid, and here's in the ways, whatever, in the kind of classic enterprise software sale. Although when it gets bigger, you are for sure doing that. Because at the end of the day, people need value, right? They have to, not only do they need to get value for the money they spend, but more importantly, they have to prioritize a bunch of opportunities, technical opportunities, and so what is the thing that's gonna be the biggest driver of their business? So the interesting challenge is that, oftentimes it's, we're gonna take out cost or we're gonna do whatever, and big data has the opportunity to transform your business, and that's always just a different sell, right? A lot of the reason why what you describe, a software as a service business or the Splunk free download and just use it piece works is that people say, I don't have to justify the thing that I think will transform my business. I'll just transform it, it's working. I'll now accelerate that or whatever. But there has to be a clear ROI story, or you will not ever prioritize, big data ahead of anything else.
Exactly, and for all our bigger deals, we always do ROI, and it's actually easy for us to do ROI. My biggest competitor is that whole value chain of companies actually putting infrastructure in place and building that real layer of 15 components. So for us, it's actually fairly easy to say, this is the cost of the, doing it in-house, and this is the cost of doing it with the data. And it has to be, for any company to spend, any reasonable amount of money these days, you have to have some sort of ROI analysis.
A question back here.
Yeah, so sort of from the space shuttle view, the original enterprise data warehouse vision was get it all in one place, and then you have all this great stuff to operate on all that data. What's so different about the new Hadoop world where I dump all the data into one big Hadoop cluster, and now all of a sudden it's more magical than and not the place where data goes to die?
I think part of it was the old model, the old EDW model is you should unify everything, and in the same way that it's like saying everyone in the company has to unify everything on one page of Excel. Find your place on the Excel spreadsheet, which are unify everything, and sit down for a year and figure out how it all fits together. And that means that possibly 90% of the data would be too hard to get into that model, and it ended up somewhere else. And so you'd end up with the EDW that was like the grand unified all that had 10% of the data and everything else would be somewhere else. And so it didn't really serve a goal. Now you're seeing these big data sources, Greenplum, one company, so T-Mobile had a 200 terabyte warehouse. We found this new data source they wanted to start looking at, cell phone tower data, that was like 2 to 10 petabytes. So 20 times bigger than their whole EDW for this other data source that might turn out to be interesting. And so in that model, what do you do, right? So Hadoop just lowers the barrier to say, let's just store all this stuff and let's figure out what's useful in a way that the old model would have been just incredibly costly and slow moving to kind of let you do that.
Yeah, you can think of all of these buckets. Traditional systems needed lots of structure and upfront thinking to make something work, and then it was very static. But boy, it can go fast. It can go really fast. What we're seeing now is this ability to just say, throw it in the system and it'll self-sort it. Let's kind of organize it once it's inside there. We'll figure it out once it's inside there. But a trade-off of speed and optimization. And now what we're starting to see is people saying, wait a second, I need that speed again. Is Hadoop really the right thing? Do I need to build a system on top of it like Platfora is doing or other systems? And we're in that interesting time because we don't know what the right answer is. But there's the really amazing thing is, thank God we finally have some choices. 5-6 years ago, you did not have choices. You couldn't do this without doing a crazy process. I can just get Splunk downloaded and go before you needed to go through this crazy RFP process and massive vendor cycle if you're working with an Oracle-style solution. I look at it, historically in social science, I don't know if there are any social science people here, but there you have the longitudinal study, and it is, in day one, we're going to ask you a bunch of questions, and then year two, and year seven, and year 30. And if in year 14, you realize that the question you should have been asking was something different, you're fucked, because it's too late. You have 14 years of non-data to answer that question.
But
It's a technical term. That's a social science term.
I'm glad you beat me this time.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's the same thing, right? Before it was you build a cube and it presumed the questions to which you would drive the answers. And now it is we gather in a massive amount of data and then we determine at some later date what are the insights we can derive from that data. And you don't throw out any of the potential insights by virtue of not asking the question in the front end. And I think that's where the incredible value is. How we figure out how to do that, you know, and derive the most value, that's where all of these guys are going to build amazing companies that I'm going to fund.
At the most simple level, it's really just the ability to iterate, right? So if you went through a 9-month ETL process 5 years ago and you got something wrong, right, you didn't add a column or anticipate all the edge cases, that's 9 months and six figures again, right? And there are a whole bunch of trade-offs involved, but the ability to ask a question, figure out the necessary and sufficient information and additional schema that's relevant to impose, and go apply that is now something, you know, that in cases can be done in minutes, hours, or days instead of 9 months. So it's harder to make as costly mistakes, although it certainly is possible.
And the reason why it took 9 months and it cost, you know, millions of dollars was this kind of, the old world of data warehouse was built around notion of single version of the truth that, you know, somehow magically, you know, company will be able to come to the notion that there is a single version of the truth, that I in sales will have the same perspective of the world as people in marketing and finance, and we will agree on one version of data, and we will all transform our way from data to that version. It's going to take 9 months, and then we will actually look at it, and nobody will see that data because it's a single version of data. So that was all driven by kind of IT desire to optimize data for storage and speed and so on. And that's why it generated no business results, because, you know, by the time IT people were done with enterprise data warehouse, the business people would send spreadsheet with their version of the tools, and it was a whole mess. So being able to store data independently from single version of the tools and the question and answers in Hadoop or big data is a huge benefit.
So how about on the, we got another question.
In terms of repetitive use cases, what are like the actual clear use cases? Like Splunk, you can clearly say, okay, Splunk log data analysis. That's a clear use case and it's winning in the market. What are the use cases that you're actually seeing and you're seeing people spend money on? It kind of goes for everybody.
In my case, you know, I usually, you know, in my case, it's anything measurable in the front office. You know, it starts, you know, the businesses today are funnels, so it starts with social, it goes through marketing, sales, you know, some operational, finance, and so on. So HR, it's always, you know, where do we get the leads, where do they come from, what's the conversion rate, what's the success rate, you know, what are the support costs. So that's 90% of the data use cases is kind of the new front office that was never really automated and never really measured.
For Splunk, it's anything with text and timestamps. So log data is the classic example. System metrics, configuration files are also good examples. Any data that comes from email systems, social data that comes from, say, the Twitter fire hose are also interesting cases to look at with Splunk. In terms of our customer base, application management and troubleshooting is clearly the first and still plurality case. And that makes for a very easy ROI story, because you can say, if my system is down, I lose this amount of money. And reducing the mean time to resolution has direct business benefits. But you can clearly layer on other types of analysis on the exact same type of data, to echo Roman's point, which is that you want to be able to have many different teams look at the same data, and there is no single source of truth. The IT team has a different perspective on the data than the security team, which has a different perspective than the networking team, which has a different perspective than the marketing team or the sales team, who each are looking at different aspects of the data, and you don't want to require that you get everything right up front for anyone to be able to use the data.
I think for us, it starts with a lot of the classic business intelligence type use cases across verticals, you know, marketing, upsell, churn, fraud type use cases, kind of understanding transactions, there's a whole wide array of these, but it gets into very quickly behaviors and populations and things like, I've got, the whole game changes if I have billions, tens of billions, hundreds of billions of events. I've got transactions, I've got trades, I've got ad clicks, social graph. Trying to think about populations of people or groups of related things. I want to look at people who have these characteristics compared to these characteristics in terms of the way they behaved in a whole lot of different ways and start to dive in and explore different directions. So things that you try to do that in Tableau and in the first 10 minutes, you've sort of blown out your memory in a machine and you've given up. How do you do this against tens of petabytes of data in a way that's fluid and you don't need a whole lot of IT support to it?
We're also talking about many of these things right here from an analysis perspective. We haven't really touched on the aspect of you're taking that data and you're turning it into a product. And here I'm specifically talking about systems like people you may know or people who viewed this item, viewed that item on Amazon or these type of recommendation tiers. When you get into that tier of stuff, you also have to really think about how do you make this scalable and how do you make this process really a true production line system. And there's a whole slew of different and very open space right now of what it means to actually build those architectures and infrastructure to make that work. You can't do it on top of a data warehouse or traditional systems.
But the other thing I'd say is, that we keep coming back, and I think it's by virtue of the nature of the people on this panel, but we keep coming back to the plumbing. But, every price optimization company that has ever existed is a big data company, right? Optimization is about understanding a lot of data and figuring out how to make the most of it. We have a company called Inrix that does traffic data. It's literally the cars driving in the road, and they gather, millions of data points a day to help you understand what is happening in real time and what's likely to happen as you drive to the Giants game. And they're just Retail Next is a company we have which collects data in brick and mortar stores and collects a ton of information about actual human beings, Mark picking up things and taking them to the register, whatever. All of these things are big data companies. All of the value is derived from gathering a bunch of data and then making the most of it and creating actionable value from that data. So I think that in large part, the things that I will fund going forward will be those things. There are lots of great companies to be built in the plumbing, but ultimately it will empower, hundreds and thousands of great companies that take data and make the most of it. And that's, that's where we are. We're right on the cusp of that explosion.
Jake, is that your view of the world as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think that resonates completely with what I said earlier, and it's really about getting the people that have this domain expertise as to what can these platforms do for you now, right? And it's again back to the use case and the people that have the vision to understand what new things data can bring to market now have a whole bunch of choices for what underlying platforms that they can build on. And while there will be a few platforms that are winners, there's a potential for hundreds or thousands of these applications to really make meaningful impacts in the market.
What about on the back end, some more in the plumbing, but on the hardware side? Is there anything that's holding you guys up or that is really critical to it, or is it interesting from an investment perspective? Or
has all been all commoditized and not really relevant?
No, I think actually we're going to see a resurgence of going back to that. Going to flash storage is a company that Greylock has funded is Pure Storage. We're seeing a lot more people. If you try to start to eke out more out of these systems, you got to get closer to the iron. I think there's going to be a tide that swings away from the cloud services like the Amazons. There's a place, and absolutely those systems make sense because you don't know quite what you're doing, you're scaling, you don't know exactly. But at some point you say, wow, the topology of the cluster actually matters. You're trying to get really high performance. You're trying to really monitor the systems because you're operating at a scale where those are real dollars. And once you get to that, it's back to the iron. How many drives can you get ratio to CPU? Are you IO bound? Are you disk bound? Those questions, they really matter a lot. And I've hit every single one of them in very recent time.
Yeah. I mean, SAP has this thing, HANA, that's basically massive processing power with a unified backplane that allows you to do incredibly rapid processing of immense amounts of data very quickly. It's a huge bet for them, right? And we're going to see people who take commodity architectures and try and figure out how to compete with that.
You know, one is, you know, lots of nodes on a cluster that are thousands of dollars, and the other is hundreds of thousands of dollars. And so which of these architectures wins will be interesting, but it means that there's going to be innovation, and you know, we're going to see them and we're going to fund them.
I think, yeah, I think from us, you know, we're more on, I guess, in the HANA end. We look nothing like it, but in the sense of scale out, heavily using memory, similar kinds of sort of scale out processing in some regards. And so we do think a lot less about IO subsystems, but I am intrigued by kind of flash moving in from disk into sort of memory tier, which is this trend is coming, and I think that's going to be pretty impactful. I mean, Pure Storage is a great company. There's a lot of great innovation on the flash side that I think is going to have a lot of impact. I think the other flip side of that is, before we talk about cloud today, when we talk to people about what we do and what their plans around big data, the sizable companies, you say, well, where, you know, is this stuff moving to the cloud? And the answer is no. I mean, it's like, it's like maybe 5-10 years. Why would I ship all this data from inside my company up to some other data center and have to worry about moving it, worry about securing it, doing all that kind of work?
And then move it back
to another. And so it's like, you want to do this where, like, data has weight, and you want to do it wherever it's most efficient from that standpoint. And so they're heavy users of the cloud, but you tend to see these big data investments where the data is being pooled, often being more based on just the centers of gravity about where it's being generated rather than some religious view of where it needs to go.
So help me understand that you guys are mainly providing software as a service.
No, we're a software company.
But software as a service.
No, we sell software.
Package software.
Yeah.
We're on-prem software, but we had the GA of our cloud offering 2 weeks ago.
On Storm.
We are SaaS-only company, cloud-only company.
And so, with the limitations that Ben just described, worry you at all? Or?
No, we control our destiny, so we control the whole stack. It's in the cloud, so we have to get a piece of the data. But don't forget, people don't need to have it back because they don't have their own infrastructure. They use good data to host it. So we are essentially their on-premise data in a sense. I also believe that for any startup, you know, selling software, it's very difficult, and I'm sure that there are some exceptions. But for us to get thousands of customers, you know, cloud was the only option. I would not underestimate what, you know, AWS and cloud services, what kind of hardware innovation they can do. We are on AWS for the last 4 years, and every year we say, well, next year we will leave AWS and build our own cluster because they don't have that service or this service. They always build it in time. So I actually think that, you know, they are very good at understanding what are the bottlenecks of companies and building it. And again, it's cloud is like electrical grid. Why should I build my own, you know, power station when I can use somebody else's? That's much cheaper.
Okay. DJ, you're an entrepreneur in residence, and maybe you'll become a venture capitalist.
Working hard at not.
Often entrepreneurs and residents go off and form their own companies or join companies. What interests you in that regard?
So I spent the last 6 months failing miserably at trying to really see if I could make a go at doing something interesting in the healthcare space. And it seems like one of these systems where the problems are obvious, the impact is massive, and the time should be now. I'll say it's very, very frustrating because you can see systems, but the ecosystem is incredibly opposed to solving these things with data. The economic alignment isn't there, the desire is frankly not there, and there's all sorts of good reasons for it, so I don't think there's any single thing aspect you can blame. Conversely, another space where I've worked a bunch of my career in is national security, which is in the last, since the 2 years after September 11th, has gone through a massive transformation of adopting technologies and rethinking and evaluating how to work on using the same. It's a massive data issue, and many of these guys here also work and touch on those spaces. But you know, when I look at it, I think that there are things that are particularly interesting right now.
I would love for someone to continue taking on these healthcare challenges, because I think it's not going to be any individual. I think it's going to be an ecosystem movement. It's going to be a community that has to apply pressure. And then the other side, I think that's going to, we're seeing this real reinvention of sitting on top of this data layer to really create something that you can, that's tangible. And those data products are things that you don't recognize as data products. And some of those things, they could be like the Nike Fuels, or they tell you that you're slow and out of shape, or to things that are just very, that are, I think the driving analogy is maps and traffic and all these things. These are great data products that we never actually say, ooh, that's a data product. And so as an EIR, what I've been focused on is really, how do I take this understanding of data and use that as a competitive advantage to actually build a company? And that should be a strategic asset rather than the thing that you just go out and straight build against.
How about the big players in the industry? I mean, Oracle, IBM, they've been using data for the last 30 years. Are they competitive with you guys? Do you see them in the sales cycle? Are they irrelevant to this?
Yeah, it's interesting. So, I mean, we've been sitting around thinking, you know, like it seems like we saw the wave of data warehousing with all the acquisitions, Greenplum and Vertica and all these companies, and then beyond that, it seems like everybody's sort of living in the last generation. That was our perception, and we knew we were a little biased, you know, from where we sit. That I was sitting at this CIO panel with one of our investors, and it was a group of Fortune, of large company CIOs. And completely unsolicited by me over lunch, they all started sharing the stories about how they've given up on the IBMs, the Oracles, you know, these companies as being kind of thought leaders. And before, they used to just ask them what's important stuff, and they used to go implement a lot of it, and that was a good model. And now they're talking literally about how they were having to retask and reshape their teams to start exploring more open source, to start experimenting and having internal labs, because they basically decided these companies were now not innovators, and that this was, from their perspective, the first time in the last 20 years that it felt like the innovation world had dried up, and they had to look to the future, and they were kind of on their own. And so I think that's very exciting for us and startups who are looking to change this space. But I think it's also a very weird time for these big companies, because suddenly they don't have those trusted partners to look to, and so they're having to look at these very sort of young and adolescent companies as being their future bets. And
sounds like they'll be buying you soon.
I think it's crazy that IBM, HP, SAS, SAP, all these guys are not on a massive buying spree in this data space right now. I think it's absolutely, they are missing the boat. If you look at how EMC has been able to massively transform and reinvent themselves with the acquisition of Greenplum, they should all be kicking themselves in the ass really hard, because they're missing the boat. And there's so much good technology from Cloudera. I mean, everyone here is in that bucket. They should be using that as a reinvention fulcrum point.
Well, I'd make two points. And the first is, obviously, in not all cases are the new big data platforms competing with the existing technologies, right? By and large, a lot of these deployments are augmentive, right? They're not ripping out necessarily and replacing something, and there's still a whole lot of opportunity for traditional relational databases to do the things that they're great at. So I think they can coexist in that regard. To DJ's point, there are a couple companies that have done fantastically well from an M&A perspective, and I think it's just a company by company strategy, right? Some folks have big enough war chests that they can wait and see how some of these platform wars play out and place bets later in the game and still remain relevant. You know, that having been said, if you look at what EMC, you know, and VMware are up to, it's going to be hard for folks to catch up.
Yeah, and I would say, you know, I'm a big believer in Christensen's innovator's dilemma, and for me, the main takeaway is don't compete with the big guys until you're ready. So your question, do you see them in your deals? No, and we shouldn't see them because we are not ready yet. At the same time, I also believe that body time will be added. The fact that we can actually be effective in a cloud environment, we can sell with good margins, we can generate profit and so on. Given that organization, the sales organization, the culture, the product design and so on, that they will have no defense. So I'm not competing with them now.
Well, I've reached the end of my questions. Anything else from the panelists or the audience that anybody wants to have addressed?
One of the items on the agenda is real time and interactivity. We haven't really commented on that. I'd be interested because many types of data appreciate with time, the value appreciates. And so what are you seeing or what are you doing to address live data while it's still actionable in time?
For Splunk, it's of paramount importance. I mean, our goal in the architecture of our system end to end is to make data retrievable within seconds after it was written to disk. And we have a strong real-time search infrastructure that lets you analyze data as it flows into the system. So that's the age of the data. The other important consideration with interactivity is when a user asks the system a question, do you have to wait 2 hours for the answer or do you see the answer quickly? And so we also feel that it's very important to provide an interactive type user interface so that the human stays in the loop. User runs a search. Perhaps we can't give them the full answer within 10 seconds, but we want to at least give them a preview of what the answer looks like so that if they made a terrible mistake in asking the question, they can ask tweak the question, ask the right question, and converge on the answer fairly quickly.
I mean, one of the other things that Splunk realized early on that I think has served them very well is that not only is it about real time, but it's about time sequenced, right? It is when did it happen and when did it happen in the context of the thing that happened before it and then the thing that will happen after it. So Splunk actually has a patent on time sequence data, the search time sequence data, machine data, and that's invaluable because at the end of the day, it is possibly the case that the ultimate value of data diminishes over time. But understanding the nature and relationship of that data over time is creates way more value in the data you're collecting at this moment in time. And I think that all of these companies are dealing with that because, you know, part of big data isn't just we churn for 6 months and we get to an answer. It's about taking your data and understanding how quickly to get to actionable results.
Yeah. I think, you know, one way to think about your question is if you think about a huge tank of water and then there's this hose feeding into it, you can think about analyzing that in two places. You can ask questions of what's in the tank of water, or you can ask questions of what's flowing in through the hose as it enters. And so you see those two classes of systems today. There's companies focused on sort of real-time questions. I want to continuously know what's happened in the last few seconds. I want, you know, stream-based was sort of an early example in Wall Street, but there's, you know, things like MetaMark and other things like that that do a great job of looking at the stream. But you can't really ask questions of the deeper data. You can only ask, and the presumption is you know the question you wanted to answer. It's actually the extreme case of that before you began, because you're only able to ask questions, you're only able to answer the question you started asking when you started watching, right? Versus questions of what's in the tank. And if you ask something in the tank, it's by nature a question and answer paradigm. You can't have a continuous answer necessarily what's in the tank. And so, you know, from our standpoint, we see most of the value today in people not knowing the questions. And so inherently the questions are what's in the tank of water. And so you need responsiveness. You need to ask a question and have an answer in less than a second. That's kind of a key premise. But the idea that you need the data from a second ago that landed, there are use cases that require that, most don't. And I think we don't necessarily focus on that. If the data's an hour old, that's probably fine for most of the questions our customers are asking.
But I mean, the power of big data is that if you have a tank full of water that, and you don't know to ask, is this new water coming in different pH than the materially different pH than the tank full of water, that the system, when it enters, will say, hey, by the way, that water that just entered is materially different pH than the waters in the system. And you go, oh, I didn't know to ask that, but shit, you know, now we'll do something about it. That's the power of big data, and that's what we're all working on.
I mean, just to add this, isn't that the difference between like fraud prevention and fraud detection, right? So if you're gonna, you know, fraud, you need your tank, for example, to do your fraud detection. That's what forms your algorithms. Your stream is where you do your fraud prevention, because as anybody knows, fraud prevention creates value because you prevent it from happening But if it's already occurred, it's almost impossible. You know, your recovery rates are what, like 80% failure there, right? So that's sort of like the two sort of play together between your stream and your tank.
And there's a continuum kind of argument there of how, what does real time mean? Like, how real is real time? And it's this kind of funny thing because, you know, certain, like in a fraud case, you may have one that have some algorithms that execute on every sub 200 milliseconds, and then you've got algorithms that you say, ah, fine, that's, you know, maybe I'm looking for some money laundering scheme, and that can take 5 hours, 10 hours, because the time scale in which that operates. And so I think the biggest thing that I would say about real time and all this stuff is, how do you add, what's the context? And most problems that people think they want real time is actually don't need to be real time, and very often you say, that should be a real time problem. And it's because you can solve it, because you're going to get a lot of benefit by not letting garbage into the water tank.
Yeah, and I mean, one additional facet, beyond sort of the reactive troubleshooting, moving to the monitoring, moving to the real time alerting, is to David's point, once you have this data, you can do really interesting things. Like, you can predict what might happen before it actually happens, and then test out theses in advance. So, you know, there's almost this time spectrum that goes from true historical to what may be in the future, let alone the responsiveness in real time.
Yeah, so we heard solutions at platform level, apps level, and also people asking the right questions and everything, but it appears to me that there's an underlying assumption that people who actually instrument and send the data into the system are doing their job properly. Because even though you may ask the right question, because the data that comes into the system is crappy, you don't get the right answers. So you, as companies providing data infrastructure solutions, what do you see on the abilities of your consumers or your users of your system to send the right data in? How do you educate them? And do you see any skills that those people need to learn?
Yeah, I want to astound that, you know, I don't view GoodData as a infrastructure. I view it as a service, and you know, taking customers' data and making sure it's in good quality and so on. In many cases, that's my responsibility. And I actually get Splunk updates from my ops people if something goes wrong, so I can call my customers and tell them, hey, you know, we have problem with some of your data, some API is not available, and so on. So I believe that it's a fundamental issue, the data quality, because garbage in, garbage out, and that's going back to, you know, my point about, you know, cloud service. 10% of my problem is software development. 90% of my problems is hosting, data quality, reliability, SLA, security, and all of the stuff that I do so that my customers don't need to do it, and data quality, and being able to, you know, take, in many cases, data automatically from places where it actually is generating, that's my responsibility.
Everything that you just described and what Roman articulated in his answer is that brittleness.
Exactly.
That's
yeah.
That is the biggest part of the problem.
I was listening to DJ talk about the real-time latency.
That's a mistake to listen.
And he was starting to morph into Mike Stonebreaker while he was talking. This keeps coming back to use case, and I'm wondering, I hear a lot of the same use cases as I do a deep dive on big data. Is there some resistance about customers to talk about their success because of the competitive advantage that they've gotten from some of these applications?
No, I think that if anything, we've seen at Splunk that when someone gets value, you just heard it. I get a Splunk, you know, alert when the data source, has some failure or whatever. And we have found, in fact, beginning next week, we're flying to Las Vegas where Splunk is having Conf 2012. And it's their big conference, and everybody on stage basically will be a customer talking about how they're using it. How, you know, websites are using it to manage and control clickstream data, et cetera, how we're using security and compliance and all these things. So yeah, sometimes you have that kind of, oh, we don't want to let you know because we're getting this advantage. But most of the time, what we've found, at least at Splunk, is that people love to say, hey, look how smart I am. You know, and so we empower them to do that. Oh, yes, how smart are you with Splunk? You know?
But I will go back to what I said when we started. I actually believe that, you know, the examples we heard, like the product you should buy on Amazon, you know, we should follow on Twitter or LinkedIn, those are the most visible successes of big data. collected information. Anytime somebody works on the data and makes you, you know, helps you to make better decision what you buy and what you see and what music to listen, and if you go to, you know, Pandora Radio and so on, those are the biggest examples of big data, and that's how most companies and consumers will actually experience big data.
I'd like to ask you a question about kind of, you said below the data platform, there's been some changes, and I'm curious if you guys are seeing an infrastructure model that's emerging. And you mentioned Flash a little bit, and you know, I can certainly see how that would play a role, but I'm wondering if there's other changes at the infrastructure layer that you guys are seeing that are having an impact or are more ideally suited for, you know, the variety of data platforms that are out there.
I think, I think that DJ's comment about a toolbox approach is very relevant. I don't think that there's a one-size-fits-all solution to data problems, let alone big data problems. You're going to want a system that looks like Hadoop, where you can store all of the files in something that looks like a file system that provides for batch job running in an efficient way, where you bring the computation to the data rather than the data to the computation. You probably want an analytic system that you can load from that file store that, say, it looks like a column store, a key value store, to be able to do large scale computation on it that you don't want to have to scan through all the data. You probably want a key value store that lets you do quick retrieval on individual items. There are many different components in a modern data infrastructure. And you probably even want a relational system to let you augment the data in the other systems.
Yeah, I think just on the last one, man, I think, if anything, it's just been more, I think there's a move to just more standard commodity hardware, and you know, being interchangeable, running an EC2 or running on standard commodity boxes, you know, getting the exotic stuff for the most part out of the equation, because that's just limiting these days.
The only advice, it sounds like if you're trying to figure some of this out of what that underlying infrastructure or architecture would be, is it's still a great unknown. And one of the things that where a lot of sharing is happening in the community, whether it's Hadoop Summit or Strata, is like, hey, what boxes are you deploying? Oh, I've got 6 spindles. What are your cores? What's your ratio look like? What are you getting out of that? And there's frankly not enough of that sharing happening, especially as the underlying stuff becomes more and more open source, whether you're using Kafka or Flume as a data bus or all these things. There's not a great, like, ooh, you should deploy with this because you're going to get a great config.
I have a question. We started off the conversation about democratization. So far, I've heard a lot about technologies. Can you link the companies represented here with specific metrics to how this actually democratizes anyway?
Sure. Would you like a concrete use case?
Pick one.
So LinkedIn, probably one of the most undata-driven companies I've ever interacted with. At the beginning, people had very little concept of understanding what was happening on the site or all those things. And now, obviously today, LinkedIn is one of the paramounts of data and using data to be truly data-driven. The way that really transformation took place was just exposing people to data, allowing people to interact with the data, allowing safe environments for people to talk about the data. You know, typically you go in and be like, here's a guy, be like, oh, you suck at this analysis, or what's your error bars, or, you know, kind of crazy, stupid arguments that don't really actually get to the gist of what you're trying to understand. Like, one graph goes down, one graph goes up. Well, let's ask, why did we get different answers? Well, the marketing guy came up with an analysis this way. The product guy came up with it this way. And by doing that, what we were trying to do is elevate everybody in doing that. Greenplum was an important part of that. Splunk was part of that, important part of that. Just giving everyone access to that democratization of data. Once that started to happen, you didn't need the powerhouse data scientists for these stupid, mundane kind of things. You freed them up for much more sophisticated questions. And that started to create this chain reaction of like, oh, we need this, and we need that, and we can build this, and we can try this. And it became a snowball effect.
Yeah, I think if you look at the way most enterprises do this, there's 100 places where democratization fails, and it's little subtle things. It's, you know, it's the, any case where I as a user can ask a question that is going to take out the system, IT has to intervene and be the mediator of that system. Anytime I want to, like, talking to someone the other day and they wanted to do something, but they weren't granted ETL privileges, so they couldn't change what was being loaded. Therefore, they had to wait 3 months for this thing to go into work queue. You just see this all over the place. And so I think part of it is just figuring out systematically how do we let people have fluid ability to do things where we make it safe. They can't miss, they can't do things that are going to force IT to have to intervene. And at the same time, then give them sharing and other things that let them collaborate and have the right social structures. But at the end of the day, it's really about the, I think, the social dynamics. You know, it's if you say, well, it's all one pool, then it's like, well, I want my resources. I'm gonna have to build my own cluster. Or I'm gonna fight to get, you know, get, if people want control, they want their turf. You know, we have to fight data hoarding. You know, all these little subtle social things shape the way people end up using the system. And I think that's part of solving the problem.
I think the most important thing to remember here is that data democratization is a means to an end. Giving people access to the data, I think Jay Parikh said last week, right? You give someone access to a 100 petabyte Hadoop cluster, that's great. That's a pile of data. That's, you know, that doesn't mean anything. What do people want to get from that data? They want to get insight, and that really comes in two forms. One, I think these are two great examples of companies that have a lot of prepackaged insight for particular use cases. Help them do their job better, right? And the other is the ability to ask ad hoc questions or elaborate on the metrics they already have to get new insights. But it's really about how do we push people and enable people to do those two things, not just to share data for the sake of it.
That's great. I wanted to thank all the panelists. You guys did a terrific job.